I'm Penn, this is my partner Teller. Tonight we're talking about safety. We're Americans. Give us liberty or give us death. We aren't afraid of anything. Well, nothing except for bacteria, mad cows, terrorists.
For decades, Penn Jillette, the larger latter half of the performing duo Penn and Teller, has been among the very best known spokesmen for libertarian ideas and attitudes in politics and culture.
Gun control, college, making prostitution illegal is bullshit. Is bullshit. 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 Welcome to Walmart. May I help you?
But Penn says that the 2016 election of Donald Trump, whom he knows well and loathes from his days on Celebrity Apprentice, and the COVID pandemic have forced him to rethink whether he wants to continue to be publicly associated with the broader libertarian movement.
Libertarianism has been so distorted. I can see arguments for not wearing seatbelts, and I can see arguments for not wearing motorcycle helmets, but I cannot see any argument for driving drunk. And that is what not wearing a mask is. It's not risking yourself, it's risking the people around you.
For many Americans, though, trillions in wasted spending, contradictory guidance from public health officials, arbitrary school and business shutdowns, and absurd policies like closing beaches and outdoor dining have made them more skeptical of government power and expertise. So why did the 2016 election and the pandemic cause perhaps the libertarian movement's most important public figure to go in the other direction? Has libertarianism changed, or has Penn? Reason caught up with him in Las Vegas on the set of his popular podcast, Penn Sunday School, to talk about Donald Trump, COVID restrictions, and whether his view of the world has really changed. Also joining the conversation was Matt Donnelly, the co-host of Penn Sunday School.
I feel a little bit like Martin Sheen in Apocalypse Now,
because well, you should.
I am like, you know, I'm a professional libertarian. I, you know, represent libertarians. That's why I'm wearing a fringe jacket, because libertarians are fringe, I guess, and whatnot. But a lot of people, when I said, you know, we talk every few years.
You're Martin Sheen.
I know.
I would like to be Brandon.
Yeah. Well, this is, you know, it gets confusing very quickly.
Sell the house, sell the car, sell the kids. I'm never coming back. I have a dream. It's a snail on the edge of a razor blade.
This is the problem, though, is that you're not Brando, because you've not only lost the weight, but you kept it off. So it gets confusing. But what I was telling people, we talk every few years, and we often talk somehow, you know, it's usually about what you've got out and about libertarianism and why libertarianism is good, et cetera. When I was telling people, well, I'm going to be talking to Penn, they were like, what happened? You know, my libertarian friends were all like, you know, what happened? He is, you know, he's gone Kurtz. He's like, he's out there in a jungle somewhere voting for Hillary Clinton and Joe Biden. He's talking about masks. And so I feel kind of like Martin Sheen, like I'm coming in here either to bring you in or to take you out.
And we're also going to show, at the end, you'll give the coordinates, right?
That's right.
Which ending are we doing? We're doing the...
The one that was released. I'm sick of, you know, director's cuts and redos. Like, it's too much.
How about the Coen brothers doing a director's cut that was shorter than the original?
I think that I can live with, always.
That was a great idea. Yeah. Blood Simple, it's 2 minutes shorter.
And
that's hilarious.
I do have John Densmore and Robbie Krieger outside, so we're going to have a weird version of the end coming in, which is also kind of really wonderful. I don't know if it's too soon to talk about Apocalypse Now.
I prayed for a mission, and for my sins they gave me one.
That's right. Are you familiar? Have you read Heart of Darkness as well? Isn't that also an intense? Just fantastic.
Apocalypse. You know, with all the talk with the offer and everything, everybody's talking Godfather. But I've always been an Apocalypse guy.
Yeah. What an incredible decade for Francis Ford Coppola, but also kind of American cinema, right?
Well, when I got the COVID time two, I guess. Mm-hmm. Time two, I think. I would only watch movies from 1972. Mm. That seemed like a symptom.
And are you done with, or is that part of long COVID now? Is that you can only watch movies from 1972?
I watch Serpico, Paper Moon, What's Up Doc, Papillon. I was just friends of Eddie Coyle.
Oh, fantastic.
I was just totally tied up in 1972.
Yeah. I watch COVID when COVID hit, and I was living in New York and it had kind of emptied out and whatnot. And I started, my girlfriend and I started watching post-apocalyptic movies. Mm-hmm. So we watched things like, Logan's Run.
Oh, yeah.
Which is incredible. And from a libertarian perspective, is kind of a dream because they escape the shopping mall that they're in and they end up in the old Capitol where Peter Ustinov, for some reason, is tending to a million cats and has a Southern accent. But it's in the grown over Capitol building and whatnot. And
what's
then
weird
they
see the accent or the cats.
You know, it's even the cats. I guess it was like a dry run for cats because they were mostly English too, right? But and the other thing that was great, and then we could actually talk about things that matter. So in Logan's Run, which I think it's from like 76 or something. So it's a little, but it's a 70s movie. And I went on a big 70s kick because we also watched The Omega Man, which is the dream everyone has who lives in LA of being able to drive without having to worry about traffic or parking. But
it comes up to what is it, Bob Dylan's 15th Dream?
Yes,
where he ends that with "I can be in my dream, you can be in my dream if I can be in yours."
Right.
That wonderful post-apocalyptic thing that Bob does, where he talks about everybody having the dream of being in the post-apocalyptic world, but they always have themselves in it and nobody else.
Right.
And Bob's final end on that is, let's have the post-apocalyptic dream with all of us in it, which is a pretty beautiful thing.
Which, unfortunately, he also updated on Slow Train Coming to where all of his so-called friends were going to be in the Lake of Fire,
that's
begging
right.
God to kill them, well, and they won't be able to
die. Do you know that the liner notes for the bootleg series of the Christian period were written by me?
Is that right?
Yeah.
I did not know that because I only listen to streaming new stuff by Dylan, but that's fantastic.
Yeah, the it was really great. Jeff Rosen, Bob's manager, gave me a call and said, Bob wants you to write the liner notes for all the Christian period.
But do you wear?
And I said to Jeff, you know I'm an atheist, right? And he said, everyone knows that. That's why Bob wants you to write it. And it was really an incredible experience. And I hadn't really dug into those records at all. And so I had to really dig. And I mean, you can imagine. I was going to say you can't imagine. But you can imagine how thrilled I was to write liner notes for Bob Dylan.
How do you feel about that period? Because, you know, I trust the song, not the singer.
Yeah.
And I call myself an apatheist because I don't have enough energy to be an atheist. And I was raised Catholic, but I don't believe in that. But I kind of was introduced to Dylan with Slow Train Coming because I'm about to turn 59. That album came out in 79 or 77, 78. So I was in high school and it was anti-Catholic. And I was like, wow, this is so fucking great. I finally get to, I understand why people love Bob Dylan, even as it was alienating his core audience. But I think it's tremendous.
It's one of his best bands.
Yeah.
Far and away one of his best bands. He was vocally so strong.
Yeah.
And he also, you know, you can separate passion from content.
Right.
And the passion was so pure.
Yeah.
And I found a lot of it. It was a wonderful experience for me because I've been just, you know, hard-ass atheist for so long. It was really, I mean, this was not Bob's intention, but it was really, I thought, eye-opening to make me address that period of Dylan. And, you know, it was, it almost was like that period was just a fuck you to me.
Yeah.
I mean, I actually got telegrams when Slow Train coming, I actually got telegrams. From a friend of mine who sends telegrams, even in the 70s, a telegram that said, you know, Bob is Christian, ha ha ha, fuck you.
Yeah.
That was the telegram I got when Bob went that way. And of course, what I write about in that is that the idea that Bob had a spiritual period is just a lie I was telling myself. There are strong Christian and religious references from the very first record to the very newest record. And it's never stopped. And it never, you know, it just went intense and was actually spoken of that way. And he has some of those weird speeches he gave on stage, like in San Francisco and stuff.
It's well, we have talked about this in the past because I had the pleasure of interviewing you a couple of months before Dylan was given the Nobel Prize for Literature. And I think we agree richly deserved. What do you think is the essence of one of the, and I want to bring this back to kind of libertarianism. In a roundabout way, because I have to, otherwise I self-destruct. I have a chip implanted in me and my corporate overlords are like, you got to bring it back.
That's not really self-destructing, is it?
No, that's true. Yeah, because, I'm part of it. Yeah, I bought in on this. I signed the contract.
I have to I have to hold myself back when people come up to me and say, can I take a selfie with you, Penn? And I say, yes. And they hand the camera to someone else.
Right.
I don't want to be the kind of asshole that says it's no longer a selfie if someone else is holding the camera. I always have to bite my tongue. It is probably my only act of kindness is not saying that.
One of the brilliant things about Bob Dylan is, and it's, I was about to say that he's constantly reinventing himself, which isn't quite true. It's that he's continuing his journey. And I think unlike a lot of rock stars, and I think unlike a lot of authors and creators, he invites the audience to come along with him. I don't think he ever, even in Slow Train Coming, where he is, you know, kind of ranting at his so-called friends and his audience. I mean, it comes out at the end of the 70s of all time that he says, no, we gotta recommit to Jesus and to, you know, a man who died a criminal's death and strip away all of this, you know, all the cocaine and the parties and the flesh pots and all of that kind of stuff. Even then, he is like, he's moving on and you're welcome to follow him.
Some rock writer, and there's a lot of wonderful ones, wrote that we don't go see Bob Dylan, he comes to see us.
Yeah.
And that really can be the feeling of the show. See, it's remarkable how he makes me redefine charisma because you cannot take your eyes off him. He's incredibly powerful. You know, certainly Judy Garland, Frank Sinatra, any of those people that are incredibly charismatic, but in such a different kind of way. You know, Joan Baez has talked about that a lot. Yeah. How you could always tell instantly that he's in a room. He's pulling everything. This Ratso Sloman, buddy of mine, he introduced Mike Tyson to Bob Dylan. And the story he tells is really fascinating because Mike Tyson had never heard of Bob Dylan. You know, we at least I lose track of how many cultures there are in the United States that don't overlap. And if you were growing up in Tyson's neighborhood, there's no reason you would ever have heard of Bob Dylan, ever. Anything. And Ratso tried everything to get Tyson to have some reaction to the name or one of the songs. Nothing. Nothing. So they meet. And Bob Dylan is very, very, very pleased to meet Mike Tyson. And they talk. And Tyson is polite, you know. And Dylan leaves. And Tyson says to Ratso, who's never heard of Bob Dylan, wow, he's a really heavy guy. You know. So what I love about that is you take away all of the cultural power that Bob Dylan has, and he still fills up the room.
Yeah.
You know, even being a borderline obsequious to Tyson, you know, not talking about music, not about anything, just you are a great boxer, let's talk about boxing. Right. Even there, even trying to be self-effacing, there's still that power there. It's a fascinating thing how human beings aren't able to codify or qualify what that is. But it sure is something, you know. When you see Brando, sure is something going on.
Yeah. Dylan, unlike, I think, Judy Garland and Sinatra, has remained, first of all, lived a longer, or has lived, continuing to live a rich, vibrant, creative life where he's still searching, he's still moving.
There's like nobody else.
Yeah.
It's really hard. You can kind of talk Picasso. You can kind of talk Stravinsky. Shakespeare, of course, you don't have that length of time.
I guess, you know, I'm not Mike Tyson, so I don't know who those people are.
But I mean, yeah. You, for that length of time.
It's amazing. I can remember watching the Bob Dylan's 30th anniversary concert, mm-hmm. where, you know, Sinead O'Connor got mm-hmm. booed. And there, yeah. And that is 40 years ago, yeah. 35 years ago or something.
That's the winding down of
yeah.
Bob Dylan's
you know,
career.
Where it's like
and what a lot of people don't notice is, I think, and I you know, it'll take 100 years to know this, but his stronger albums, maybe his strongest mm-hmm. albums, are in the 21st century.
Yeah, that I want to believe. We'll see. I mean, I don't want to say peaked, but Time Out of Mind is the album mm-hmm. that I keep coming back to, mm-hmm. but it varies at different moments. What I was going to say about him and bring it back to you and kind of libertarianism and the way that you've been talking about it since Trump mm-hmm. and COVID is that what I find, and I have a lot of friends who are like, would you shut the fuck up about Bob Dylan? You know, and even their parents.
I've had that sentiment.
Yeah, yeah. I'm sure. I suspect Mike Tyson. It's like, I find Bob Dylan charismatic, but I wish you would shut the fuck up about him. And I go, okay, sure, Mike. But you know what is interesting about Dylan is that he continues to grow and change and evolve. And it's, you know, sometimes he's clearly reacting against a former self or a younger self in another way. And you're talking about like the Christian imagery of him, it is there from the beginning, and then it becomes, okay, well, what's the story of Christ that he's following? And I can't believe I'm saying these things because it isn't something I believe theologically, but kind of in a metaphorical sense. Dylan is always kind of growing and changing and evolving and observing the world, which I find amazing, and his most recent record is like that, even if it's made of tracks that were from the past couple of, you know, recorded over the past couple of years. It's just kind of amazing. And it strikes me, and here I am being obsequious to you, but in all good faith, you're kind of like Dylan. What is interesting is when you go back and look at early statements of you, especially, you know, in the 80s, I guess, you know, I would see you on PBS mm-hmm. and things like that. And, you know, when you were in your biggest asshole phase, where you were, mm-hmm. you know, the larger, louder half of Penn and Teller, and you were, you know, very bombastic, you were very confrontational, things like that. Even there, you could see you were a man in process, you were changing. So can we talk about what happened? What was it about Trump first that shook your faith in your long-held, very public, very persuasive belief of libertarianism, and then COVID? And where are you now? Because we're coming out of that phase.
Well, I'm going to, I'll give you a real answer.
No.
Okay. Then I'll give you the other.
This interview is over.
The one thing that I always thought was, and I believe at the time I was aware of it. I remember once, being I think it was Politically Incorrect. It was Politically Incorrect. I mean, it was Bill Maher.
Yeah.
But I think it was Politically Incorrect. And yeah, it was Politically Incorrect. And there were.
Wait, know, are you sure?
Yeah.
Was it Politically Incorrect or was it?
There are four seats. There are four seats yeah. there. And then there's Bill's seat there. And I was out there because I know Bill forever. I was out there before the other guests. Mm-hmm. No. And I'm sitting in the chair there. And I mean, this is completely sincere, completely sincere. There was no jive in this at all. I'm sitting there and I'm talking to Bill. He's going over his notes and I'm going over my notes and we're just casually. And I go, you know, this is funny because you got Clinton's drug policy guy here. Mm-hmm. And this person here is, you know, a writer for the Times. And this other person here, I said, usually you have one nut. There's usually one nut sitting in the seat here. And then he just looked up at me. And it wasn't even a gag. Yeah. Neither one was doing a joke. He just kind of went,
yeah.
And I went, oh, I'm the nut. And it was an absolute revelation. I mean, anyone else would just say, how blind can you possibly be that you didn't know that? But it's the poker thing. If you don't know who the fish is, you're the fish. I was the nut. And I was very happy with that role. I saw the asshole period pen, the bullshit period pen, as you always want somebody, you know, in the gay rights movement, you wanted to have the Jonathan Rauches. You needed them. They were really important. But you also needed the flamboyant crazies. All of those were necessary. And I saw my role in society as you know, in culture, as I'll be one of the ones who just says whatever pops into his fucking head. And that's always needs to be considered. And, you know, many times, and I was interviewed on CNN or places like that, and they'd ask me about libertarianism, which I also will say, unlike you, I've never been a spokesman for libertarianism. Mm-hmm. I mean, de facto,
right,
but never claimed to be. I would always say, all I want is in every discussion we have, somebody to say, is it possible this problem could be helped by more freedom instead of less? And I believe that the knee-jerk reaction is always, we need less freedom to solve a problem. I think you even do that, we even do that in our personal lives. Whenever you want to solve something, you think of constricting. And I thought what opened my eyes the most about libertarianism, and at a very deep level, what libertarianism was let's look at novel solutions to things that really exist in more freedom. And I always said many times, the answer may be no.
Right.
The answer may be no. I mean, if someone is running through town with a gun, shooting people, killing people at random, and you're trying to stop that person and you say, can this problem be solved by giving this person more freedom? The answer can be no. It can be no. But that should always be considered there. And there's a line by Nick Lowe, and I've forgotten what song it is, where he just says, it's just not funny anymore. You know, when Abby Hoffman and Jerry Rubin were doing the raising the Pentagon and all that stuff and running a pig for president, that was beautiful stuff. It was a beautiful kind of theatrical thing.
Right.
And what happened with Trump was the pig won. And all of a sudden, and I believe if you're looking for an intellectual answer, you're not going to get it. It's emotional. All of a sudden, and I think a small part, I can't claim, because I think everybody else had the experience, many other people had the experience too. But a small part of me, because I knew Trump and knew him fairly well, that all of a sudden I said, the idea of a loudmouth saying whatever pops into his head and people listening to that and playing with that, all of a sudden that's not fun anymore. All of a sudden people are going to really suffer because of this. And I was very fortunate in that one of the jobs that I had as a pundit, as a talking head, that just went away. Because nobody was being put on TV unless they were saying something directly about Trump. That whole kind of playful politics kind of went away. And when playful politics went away and nuts became real players, all of a sudden I no longer had a role. Because what I kind of always wanted, and I would talk to my friend LOD, Lawrence O'Donnell, and, you know, we were a very unlikely friendship. One of my closest friends for many, many years. The absolute symbol of anti-libertarianism.
Right.
And we were very, very close friends and still are. And I would always say, I feel comfortable, really comfortable, saying these things that I believe. I'm not saying that they just to be provocative. I really honestly believe them, but I have a safety net that there are grown-ups saying, okay, Penn, you had your say. Those are all good points. We're listening to it. But we're going to be, the ship's going to take a long time to move. Mm-hmm. And maybe I was hoping that the whole libertarian movement would get us a kind of a smaller government, kind of do this, kind of more freedom, but it would all be kind of slow. You know, it's like when Ralph Nader said when he was running that the world was controlled not by the government, by corporations. I said, well, the one thing he's got wrong about that is that that's a good thing. Hmm. You know, he right. thinks it's a bad thing. And I kind of thought, I really believed, and I mean, this is, I really believe this. I don't think I want to qualify it to appear to be smarter, but I'm not smarter. I really believe this. I believe that when one became president, there really were a group of people that right. came into you and said, okay, you did your speeches, you mm-hmm. did your stuff, you did a good job, you're tall, you yeah. made your point on camera, that's really good. Here's the stuff we really got to do. Mm-hmm. I really believe that happened and that everybody was pulled a little bit more towards sanity. And Trump proved that isn't true.
Sure.
You can stay a nut. And so I would say emotionally what people are feeling about me being pulled away from libertarianism mm-hmm. is that I get scared.
Yeah.
I get scared. And I think that's...
Can I ask what...
Sure.
What are you scared of? Because like I, you know, and again, we talked last, I think, in 2016, and it was before the election. And I think we shared broadly a critique of Trump. You know, and certainly Trump is no libertarian.
No, I know.
Some people are like, oh, he's the most libertarian president ever. And it's like, I don't even know how to begin to kind of parse that sentence. But, you know, and he was truly terrible on things. I mean, for me, it starts with immigration and his rhetoric about Mexicans and foreigners. It's like, I look at my family.
You're out when he comes down the bottom of the escalator.
Yeah, no, I was like, pretty much. Yeah.
It was the first sentence.
Yeah. It was kind of amazing because he was like, you know, I'm not going to be politically incorrect. And by the way, Mexicans are rapists.
Yeah.
And they're not just rapists. They're disease-ridden rapists who have drugs in their back pocket. I'm like, this is not my guy, certainly.
Yeah.
So there was a lot to talk about, you know, and critique
and
Trump.
And I don't think you can avoid the important fact that he was the first president in the history of the United States that wasn't smarter than me.
Yeah, than you.
Yeah.
Okay. And that, if we may say, is a low bar.
Sure.
Right? We're talking
exactly.
maybe double, high, triple digit, or high double digit
high
IQ,
double digit,
if we
sure.
believe that kind of thing.
Wherever we want to do, wherever you want to put the IQ,
right.
put it anywhere you want. You can go, you can go from 90 to 140, and you're still going to be okay on that.
Right, right. You know, before we get to COVID, and you said, you know, you kind of felt scared because you thought in your head there was this reserve of, I don't know, responsible people mm-hmm. that would keep the government that you spent a lot of time railing against,
yep.
rightly, for things like bad immigration policy. I mean, immigration under Obama was terrible and under George Bush. War under these guys was terrible.
Terrible.
Surveillance, terrible.
Terrible.
Economic policy, terrible. But that the people who were kind of keeping them within bounds disappeared when Trump was elected? Or... I mean, what are you afraid
or they
of?
Could be, yeah. They could be overruled.
Yeah.
And also that the fact that I think we're talking, and once again, it's all emotional.
Sure.
The nuts could have power.
Right.
The nuts could get power. And
I mean, it is kind of amazing. And I do think that there's like the... And I want to come back to this in relation to Biden in a bit, but that, you know, the idea of Trump winning is like something out of a Philip K. Dick novel.
Yeah, exactly. Right?
I mean, it's like, 100%, it's yeah. you could imagine it and dream it, but then when it becomes real, you realize, oh, holy shit, I am being dreamed by a robot who is about to be shot by like a talking penguin or something like that. This is a strange world. And for you, that is like a horrifying reality or recognition.
Yeah. It was... the many, many, many people that I really respect and really like would say stuff the equivalent of burn it down.
Yeah.
Fuck it. We don't care.
And then when you saw the fire catching on, you were kind of like...
Well, I never went along with that.
Right.
But I would kind of listen to that and go, that's a point of view I can listen to.
Yeah.
And then when it started happening, I remember one guy in Hollywood that I was talking about a project with. I mean, just while Trump was running, I was, maybe going to write something or something. And he said, oh, yeah, I'm voting for Trump just to fuck everything up.
Yeah.
That's all I wanted to do, is fuck everything up. And I believe he was completely sincere. And I kind of thought, oh, geez, because I guess I knew him. And I guess if you didn't know Trump, you could believe some sort of horrible conspiracy thing. It would be so much more comforting to believe that the reins had been taken by an evil genius. Mm-hmm. People were always saying, second guessing him.
So there was always a difficulty with him. People, no matter what he was doing, some people were saying he's being an impulsive baby. Other people were being like, no, this is another next level sophisticated.
He's 30-dimensional chess type of genius.
Kind of thing.
Yeah.
And either way, it was resulting in the same crap. Yeah. Like, the movie didn't change anything.
I feel, and I guess I can't prove this, but I feel I had an inside track to knowing that it was an impulsive baby.
It was an impulsive baby.
It was, absolutely. Yeah. And that there was not even one other level. He was not at the checkers level. never mind, three-dimensional chess. And I just thought, I also, there's a kind of, I'm going to jump topics entirely because I think maybe this is what you asked me. Mm. To be an atheist and to be libertarian grows out of, to me, a huge amount of optimism, a breathtaking amount of optimism.
You are a pathological optimist.
Yes.
Yes.
Ridiculous. And I really, really do not believe in evil. Mm-hmm. That's still true. I think that evil is a religious concept.
Right.
I really, I would argue with Bill Maher about this all the time. I'm as far from cynic as you can get, and cynic and skeptic get thrown together.
If I may, I remember this may have been an early time when I remember you. I was watching Politically Incorrect, and somebody was on talking about how we're running out of aluminum for cans, and they were like, "This is, the end times are upon us." And you told a little parable about how, like, well, we used to use tin cans and we started running out of tin and it got too expensive and people figured out how to use aluminum. Mm-hmm. And you said quite, and it kind of stunned the other people on the panel, the nut saying, and I'm confident that whatever comes after aluminum we'll come up with because humans are really fucking good at, creating the next thing that helps the species.
So that kind of huge, huge optimism, I really, really believed, I really believe that. And I think that this combination of swirling things, of Donald Trump making me really scared of silly rhetoric in a serious realm. I think I would have felt exactly the same way if Abby Hoffman had won in 68. You know what I mean? I loved Abby Hoffman. I fucking loved everything about Abby Hoffman. I loved everything he said. I loved everything. I loved running the pig for president. If Abby Hoffman had been our president in 68, I think I might have felt a similar horror to Trump. Now, Abby Hoffman had many IQ points on Trump.
If we're being honest, so does Pegasus, right?
Pegasus, yeah. Right. And Abby Hoffman also had, I think, if not a large amount of compassion, at least mm-hmm. some.
Yeah.
Not totally solipsistic. And, but I would have felt very similar, yeah. very, very, very similar to that. So Trump hit, and I really felt that danger of that. Mm-hmm. And when the virus hit, there was an amazingly, for the pathological optimist, there was an amazing feeling of how connected we were. I mean, I always knew, if you'd asked me intellectually, you know, is the whole world that connected?
Right.
I would have said, well, yes, of course. There's no doubt about it. But man, when they were getting virus reports, every bit of the world within 2 weeks, it was just like, wow, we really are.
Yeah, we're on spaceship Earth. We're in the global village. We're all interconnected.
Becomes really true. Yeah. And I was willing, if you'd frozen time right then and said, how will, and I got to do all this shitty kind of language stuff you mm-hmm. have to do. How will people who call themselves libertarians react? Mm-hmm. I don't want to. That will only go from...
Is this kind of like calling pregnant women birthing
yes,
persons?
Yes, exactly. Okay. But I'm saying that that's important.
Yeah. Right, right.
Because yeah. I don't want to. I respect you enough to yeah. not do the argument I want to do, which is I didn't change at all. The movement changed. That's
right.
always bullshit.
Right.
That's always okay. bullshit. People who call themselves libertarians.
Yeah.
I would have bet anything at that point. You know, I would have given you yeah. long odds that the libertarians were going to be at the forefront of masks mm-hmm. and vaccines.
Yeah.
Because the libertarians are going to say, this is something we can do voluntarily mm-hmm. that'll help other people and help ourselves. We can do that instantly. And when I got a phone call, email.
A telegram.
A telegram. I use those interchangeably. Yeah. When I got an email saying there's going to be an anti-mask rally in mm-hmm. Vegas, and we're certainly counting on you to lead it. Mm-hmm. And I was like, what?
When was this? Not pinpoint, you know, but...
You know, that whole time is a blur.
Yeah.
It was early on.
Early.
Yeah.
Early. It was before there were serious
still masks. Lockdown, still show shutdown.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, okay. Certainly. Right. Yeah.
But we're not talking like this is in February or March 2020.
No.
Yeah.
Late June, early July.
Yeah.
So I was just horrified. Mm-hmm. And then I said, no, I'm not going to do that. And the answer came back, well, do you think it's the government's job to mandate masks? And I wrote back, well, no, but we're not talking about that.
Right.
I want everyone to wear a mask.
Yeah.
I want everyone to wear a mask.
At that point in time.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I want everyone to wear a mask. Yeah. I don't want the government to mandate it. I mean, I just want everybody to do it.
Yeah.
And I want fucking every motherfucker to be vaccinated.
Right.
And my thought about freedom there was this is, and you know, it's a very easy parallel to me. It's not seatbelts.
Right.
It's drunk driving.
Right.
And those are two different things.
Right.
And I mean, we have to of course put out health care, because if we are all paying for each other's health care, it is not your right to ride without a helmet.
But that's an argument so that we're not paying for each other's health care.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I'm with you there. But I'm just saying that when people who call themselves libertarians, people who birth, when they started saying, don't wear masks and don't get the vaccine.
Right.
That
or
was
even going to a point, if I may, to extend the point, if some people calling themselves libertarian went so far as to say, there should be laws passed against businesses mandating.
We're not even there yet. We don't need that yet.
Well, because
once you get to that, I go completely insane.
Right.
Once someone who calls themselves a libertarian says, we're going to make a law that says a private company cannot say you can have to wear a mask on their property.
Yeah.
We're done. So, I just explode. I'm trying to give it the benefit of the doubt
right.
and go earlier. I was just saying, you know, the idea that not wanting things to be forced
right.
is the same as not wanting to do them
right.
is something that was one of the differences mm-hmm. I wanted to tease out all the time.
Right.
I mean, how many times had I gone on TV and said, I want drugs to be legal. Mm-hmm. I don't want to use
right.
them. That's so easy right. for me to say.
Well, it's this is, and the analogy here is I can be pro-vaccine, but anti-mandate.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. And I will tell you right now, I believe, and once again, emotionally, I believe that if people representing as libertarian had come out strongly and said, you know, we're 500 people here. Mm-hmm. We are 100% vaccinated. We're all right. wearing masks. And you know something? We're going to show up vaccinated and masked and socially distanced and say this should not be done with force.
Right.
I would have been there every day.
Yeah.
Every single time.
Can I reel it back a little bit, though, to Trump and Trump taking over? And Matt, I'm interested in your take on this as well.
Well, then you are the only one.
Yes, I know. and that might even be less after I hear your opinion. Yes. I may be joining the majority here, right? But, you know, you said when Trump won, you're kind of like, holy shit, like there's no restraint or anything like that. For me, I have to say on a certain level, after he won, it was amazing. And I thrilled to the idea that somebody like him who has no qualifications is running against the most establishment who, if there is a deep state, they were in the tank for Hillary, et cetera. Like she mm-hmm. really mm-hmm. fucked it up not to win. Like she mm-hmm. really overslept. She's like the American sprinters in the 1972 Olympics who were like, oh fuck, like the final was, 2 hours ago, maybe we can still make it. Really, really bad, right? But then when he started to, first off, he didn't change enough things. He was constrained and in many ways, when he started to say, we're going to take troops home, suddenly things erupted. Like there was, he was hemmed in by many things. Like what exactly changed? The government kept spending more money, mm-hmm. Spending went up under Trump.
But he never wanted to go down.
I guess, yeah, but that's what, I mean, I guess for me-
He just wanted to go into his pocket,
some of it. Part of it was the problem with Trump is that he was not a break with the way things were going. He was kind of a continuation. The rhetorically,
almost like the worst
he's a bomb thrower. Yeah.
What he did is he did the thing that was attractive to a lot of people, which is took away the pleasantries and the doublespeak of power brokering.
Right.
And was a shameless power broker. It was an open power broker,
yeah.
or whatever. And kind of gross about it.
Right.
And so I think
which is uncomfortable, right? But
yeah.
but also kind of like, okay, maybe this we'll get to a point where we really do radically change the size, scope, and spending of government, because there were all those early headlines of people in the center and on the left who were scratching their heads saying, maybe when we were extolling executive power under Obama,
mm-hmm.
maybe we made a mistake.
That
was our hope here.
That was right. our hope. We carried yeah. on a lot about that.
Yeah.
That, okay, so,
yeah.
yeah. Trump shouldn't have executive power, neither yeah. should Obama.
Right.
I was really hoping that this would be part of reeling back the power of the presidency.
Right.
Which had been so out of control.
Yeah.
With 40 years, pick amount of time. But
yeah.
Terrible, terrible, terrible. And I thought maybe we'd learn our lesson on this.
Right.
And when I was watching the debates going up, who was going to go up against Trump, the Democratic
right.
primary debates, I was waiting for one person to say, well, the one thing I'm going to yeah. do is cut back executive privilege so this doesn't happen again.
Yeah.
And not one of them said that.
Right.
It was just how they were going to use it. And it was that power race to that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, you know, before COVID, what were the things that Trump was doing that showed there, you know, there was no continuity between a bad situation under Obama and from a libertarian point of view that you agreed with? And you were certainly not an Obama hater in any kind of weird way, but it's, you know, as a critic mm-hmm. of like mm-hmm. a government that does too much and spends too yeah. much. You know, what was the big change under Trump that, like, you were like, holy cow, this, he is going to burn it down?
Boy, that's really, really tough, because you kind of hit it. The immigration mm-hmm. under Obama was terrible.
Right.
And I guess if I were trying to perceive myself as cold and intellectual, I would say, well, there wasn't much difference. Mm-hmm. But the outright racism mm-hmm. of Trump, even though the policies might not have changed that much, clouded everything. Mm-hmm. Clouded everything for me.
Yeah. Macho taunting over Twitter, the idea that our foreign policy was in the hands of an impulsive tweet yeah. was frightening in the moment for me.
And the fact that I was number 7 on his hate list, according to the
New York Times. You wanted to be higher? yeah. Or you were like, come on.
No, but exactly. Yeah. That was not a small thing.
Yeah, yeah.
And well, not because it was me.
Right.
But because a political figure had an opinion on a magician.
Yeah.
I found horrific. You do not see Lyndon yeah. Johnson going, boy.
I think Gerald Ford was pretty anti-Doug Henning. So he was like, you know, we got to take this motherfucker. I don't care.
We had Twitter then.
If I don't get reelected, I'm doing, you know.
Boy, you were able to pull up a politician, a magician in the same period of time.
Yes.
That's Dennis Miller level there.
No, this is, I think my brain has been shutting down over the past 40 years. So there's these last few.
I remember early when he, yeah. Either late in his election or early when he was elected, he said, Penn said something in an interview, and he went after Penn on Twitter and said, that's why I fired you. Right? And I, at the time, tweeted back, like, he was on a game show that you hosted. Penn didn't work for you. He didn't put in a job application.
Yeah, yeah.
He went on a game show that you hosted that NBC cast.
Well, we have a lot of funny things about that. The fact yeah. that he said Penn was totally unknown before he did Celebrity Apprentice.
No, that's true.
And I tweeted yeah. back, the name of the show was Celebrity Apprentice.
Yeah.
yeah. But I believed him.
Yeah.
I believed he was that delusional. I believe in his yeah. head, he held well, that, the actual
That's yeah. the thing I say. I don't believe that Donald Trump ever lies.
No, I mean, in this, to bring it back to Bob Dylan, and I can hear various people groaning already, I believe Bob Dylan believes absolutely everything he is singing at mm-hmm. the moment he is singing it, and then his beliefs change. I mean, and this is not to equate Donald Trump with Bob Dylan, but yeah, I agree with you that Trump never lies. He just doesn't have any coherence.
You read the book by, what's the guy's name, Frankfurt or something, on bullshit.
Yeah.
On bullshit. Mm-hmm. That great thing where he separates bullshit from a lie.
Right, right.
That a lie respects the truth, and that's yeah. it's going counter to it. And bullshit just doesn't care. Yeah. It just rolls over right. it. I believe that. Also, you know, that's, there's a new book out about Bob Dylan, the early time. And it says that one of his road crew has this wonderful, I didn't memorize it, this wonderful quotation about Bob that says, everybody's looking for the person who wrote The Times They Are A-Changin'. Mm. And the person that wrote The Times They Are A-Changin' only exists when that song's being sung. Yeah. And that just, like right. a diamond bullet, if we want to yeah. cover everything together, that was like a diamond bullet to me. And I went, yeah. right, when Bob Dylan is singing The Times They Are A-Changin', right. the person singing that song believes every word of it.
Right.
But the second it goes on to It Ain't Me, Babe,
right.
it's a different guy.
Yeah.
It's a different acting. And I think what we've got with Trump, the only mistake I would make in that yeah. comparison, the only thing I would want to make a little finer point on is that when an actor or a singer or a performer believes something in the moment, We have a box for that, right, of being within a proscenium. When someone who's in the public eye and responsible for that believes everything at that second, we no longer have something that's
justifiable. Yeah, it's uncontainable. The whole world's his stage, and that's kind of creepy, right? So, but, you know, did Trump, I mean, was it mostly, is it, and you were saying, I appreciate the honesty, and I don't question it, that it's, a lot of it is emotional. Mm-hmm. And, but did policies change?
You know, we tried to have this discussion, a group of friends, trying to say, you know, he's killing fewer people than Obama.
Right.
He's killing fewer people than Obama. He is killing fewer people than Obama.
But that tweet, these are not the things that should be commensurate, right?
Yeah.
It's like he's killing fewer people. That's kind of good.
That's kind of everything.
Yeah.
That's all of it.
Yeah.
So I tried to say, and I said this a zillion times, I guess not publicly, right, but we're not really talking publicly. Mm. Not all I'm addressing. I tried to look before COVID really seriously at Trump and said, if I am a peacenik, mm-hmm, which I am, I think I'm the worst kind of peacenik, probably to a fault. And you said to me, Nick came to me in, 2015 and said, we're going to put a guy in power that you hate more than anybody you could possibly hate. He is going to embarrass you with everything he says. He is going to make all your friends go crazy, but he is going to kill 25% fewer people around the world. I think I'd make that bargain really fast.
Yeah.
Really fast. And I think that kind of happened.
Yeah.
It's hard to say what I would think about this whole thing if COVID hadn't come along.
Right, right,
right.
Which also, he developed the vaccine faster than Biden.
That's right. And also, I want to get into this because it's weird. He created Operation Warp Speed, or kind of like put that in place in a way that certainly Hillary
let it happen.
Yeah. Well, if presidents get the blame, they get the credit for that.
I give him full credit for
that. But then he was hiding that for most of his presidency. It's like, I'm
spending time talking about hydrochloroquine at a weird amount of time.
Yeah.
And that's the thing. It's like, same with they brought people home from war. At the same time, he kind of, he spoke like no other president would have spoken about Charlottesville, right?
Right.
Very early on in his presidency. And there's no doubt about the amount of, outward racism that's brewed up.
He gave space for it in a way that was unimaginable 6 months before.
Talk about.
Yeah.
And empowered racists.
There's no doubt about that.
Yeah.
Okay, so, but here, and again, because I don't care about Trump, and I don't, in the COVID years. Okay, so let's, kind of fast forward
to the page of the COVID years.
the hands of time, right? But, January 2020, February, March, Trump, weirdly, he was both omnipresent. He was in the room every day talking, but then not saying very much and not dictating very much. But the parts of the government that maintained monopoly control on public health, the FDA and the CDC, who were kind of at war with Trump, right? This is what we hear, they weren't taking orders from him and they didn't, but they fucked up everything from the beginning in January when the first cases were found in Seattle. Somebody like Anthony Fauci was like, hey, don't wear masks. Masks are bullshit. Don't wear masks. And then it's like, come back.
He was saying that we needed the masks for the...
No, he was not. He was saying masks were ineffective. Mm-hmm. Don't do it. And he's since copped to saying, I was doing that because I didn't want to run on PPE. He also, at one point was saying, what we need for herd immunity was this percentage, but I was lowballing that because I didn't want people to get freaked out.
Right.
And so, I'm not this, in no way am I stumping for Trump on any of this stuff, but it seems to me part of the issues with the way we responded to COVID was the continuation of the government pre-Trump.
Yeah, well,
that is problematic.
Also, you have one of the true proofs of some of libertarians' thoughts. Right. I mean, libertarians have been fighting forever against the nurses and doctors being able to cross
state lines and things like that, different licensing.
Right. Yeah. And that ended
suddenly,
up
suddenly, yeah, they were like, oh, you know, that's not so important that you sit for 6 hours in a room and, you know, so Massachusetts can rip you off for $800 to practice from New Hampshire.
There was, and I was saying that a lot. There was a lot of stuff in early COVID where libertarians were being shown the stuff the nuts were saying for the past 30 years was completely right.
Right.
This licensing stuff, this all this kind of stuff, it's all hands on deck. We got to do that. That was just simple graft. Right. They're just ripping off money. The government's just ripping it off and slowing things down. And now we know it. Completely right.
Yeah, if I may also, you know, I live in New York City. And, you know, when COVID started, you know, Andrew Cuomo and Bill de Blasio was the mayor of New York at the time. Andrew Cuomo was the governor of New York. Hate each other. I mean, they are really like, you know, just, you know, the toad and the scorpion in a death match all the time. But they both were saying right up until they shut down New York and especially the city, they were like, hey, you know, this isn't a big deal. You got to go out. We got to support the businesses. I mean, they were telling people to basically go out and open mouth kiss and buy, you know, put the guacamole on everything. We need that money injected into the economy. And then they shut everything down. And it turned out that Andrew Cuomo was, you know, taking old people who were not infected with, you know, who were sick and putting them all in the same room so that they could all be together. And then it turns, you know, and die at very high rates and then lied about it. And I bring this up not to, because like you, you know, and in a lot of ways, I should say, I think my libertarianism growing up was informed by reading Reason Magazine and probably a lot of the stuff that you were saying, because you were always at odds to say, I'm not an anarchist. I believe in some government. I'm with you completely on that. But I'm bringing this up because these were not, it wasn't Trump and it wasn't the federal government and it wasn't people who were saying burn it all down. It was people who had been in power for a long time exercising that power in ways that were horrific and then kind of running from the consequences of it.
There was a lot of it.
Yeah.
There was a lot of it. And I was aware of that too, you know. And I was also really, really interesting to see, you know, to see how much we learned from that. And one of the things that, you know, I remember when they, I would never be a spokesperson for the James Randi Educational Foundation, because I said, I'm a loose cannon, you know, and I will say stuff you don't want to be associated with. So I've never spoken for American atheists. I've never spoken for the humanitarians. You know, I've never.
I would love to be in the meeting where the humanitarians are saying, "We need you, Penn." It's like, God damn it!
Oh,
you're a loose cannon, Penn.
No,
you're going to make people be inhuman.
I'm telling you. But the nutty thing was the asteroid people.
Right.
The people that are trying to protect us from getting hit by an asteroid. They said to me, would you be on our board and would you speak about this? And I said, you don't want me. And he said, no, I really think you want me. And I said, well, do me a favor, on this next email, CC everybody on your board and all the important people. And he sent me an email saying, we'd like Penn to do this. Yeah. This is Penn. And I wrote back, I use the word cunt. That was it.
That's a really great strategy. I hope a lot of kids in grammar school are listening to this because this is a way to get out of a lot of stuff in school, right?
Exactly. No, but I mean, you understand.
Yeah.
And maybe it too, by the way.
Yeah.
And they understood it in exactly the spirit I meant it. They were not offended. Yeah. I mean, you want to tell that story of, oh, they ran screaming from the room, but they went, oh, yeah. You are going to make a joke. You are going to do this kind of stuff. We don't want to be explaining this forever.
Yeah.
But you don't, you know. So I, all of this is coming around to, I believe what's a cop-out. I believe this is a cop-out. So you can bust me on it. But
okay.
Let me know that, I know you're going to. I've tried to always say, I'm speaking for myself.
Yep.
And I've tried to always say I'm not speaking for a group. Mm-hmm. I have not been afraid to take stuff I've read in Reason magazine and repeat it on TV. I've not been afraid to do that. I've not been afraid when they said that I self-identify as a libertarian to not have the camera come up and go, no, no, no. I have allowed myself to be seen by maybe a few people as a spokesperson for certain things, but I've also tried to protect myself in a certain way and say I'm speaking for myself. So I've seen some, you know, not much, because I try not to read anything with my name in it, so I haven't seen much of this. But I'm aware that some people are disappointed in things that I've said. I don't think they can be disappointed in someone whose show was shut down for 421 days.
Right.
Who shut down his show for 421 days. Yeah. We were never actually shut down by anybody, by the
way. Was it? There was a lockdown in Vegas, though, wasn't there, for a period of time?
But this maybe speaks to the libertarian thing very strongly. March 13th, March 12th was the last day of shooting Penn and Teller Fool Us, 2020. It was the last day of shooting that. Probably, Matt, you remember.
Yeah, that was a weird day.
Last 2 days, 11 and 12.
Yeah.
We were wondering if we should be shooting
at all.
At all.
Our studio audience declined by about 75%.
Right.
People who were going to come in and willingly.
And so they were like, they're like, hey, something fishy's going on.
We
had
people flying in from China. Wow. We were going, geez, I don't know if we should.
People from 14 countries on that season.
Right. Yeah.
And your theater in the Rio is, you have a sister casino in Wuhan, right?
Yeah. So that was the 12th.
Yeah.
The 13th was a Friday that we had off. And the 14th, some of these days may be wrong, but I think I'm right. 14th was a Saturday.
Yeah.
And that Saturday night, I won't over-dramatize it and say we were sold out, but I believe we had like 800 tickets sold. Very good night.
Yeah.
We're coming back after 2 weeks off. Boom. A lot of tickets sold. And there was an article in the Times from France, from a guy who wrote what we would do in France if I knew what I know now
right.
2 weeks ago.
Yep.
And we were just about, I mean, this is all sloppy and poetic. We were kind of 2 weeks behind Europe, kind of, sort of. And we were set to go on Saturday. And I was on the phone that Saturday with Glenn and with Teller for 5 hours. We were on the phone. Off and on, but pretty much a lot of on, saying, should we do the show tonight? And the Rio and Caesars were going, yes, you're doing the show tonight. And tickets were selling. It wasn't like ticket sales had dropped off.
Right.
Tickets were selling. We went from like, I believe we went from like 700 to 900 during this discussion. We're going, we're going to do the show. There's nothing's changing. There's no rules from the government coming down. Caesars isn't shutting down. And I said, I don't feel like we should do the show. I don't think we should do the show. I don't think I want to be part of pulling people into that room. We're completely safe, you know, because we can just not do the meet and greet afterwards. We're on stage. There's good ventilation. But I remember I was tortured.
It was tough. Yeah. Also because I wasn't sure who'd lead the way. Like, the NBA was canceling games, but not the whole season.
Yeah. Right.
So we finally said at 5 o'clock, we're not going to do the show. And then Caesars was unhappy. And I said, fine. If Caesars wants to sue us for the income for that when everything's okay on Monday, okay, they can. And maybe they're right. Maybe they win and we give them money. I don't care. But I don't want to do the show tonight. And then I called up David Copperfield. And I said, don't do your second show tonight, man. Hmm. And he said, what, they're not, I said, I think maybe, and I called the Piff, and I said, just, maybe we should start this. We should just do it on our own, start this. And then someone at Caesars, it's not speaking for all of Caesars, it's just one person, and we don't really blame them because no one knew what they were talking about, said, we're going to shut down everything on Monday, but do the shows tonight and Sunday.
Right.
And I said, no, that there's no way that that logic makes sense. If we should shut down Monday, we should shut down Friday.
Right.
You know, the sooner the better. So everything in the world was functioning fine then. If you wanted to look at how the world should run, in my point of view, it's that people should care about bringing people together, and they should say, we are canceling our shows. We don't really need this. And I don't think there would have been, I don't think you would have this, I'm going to go to Vegas and talk to Penn Jillette about what the fuck went wrong. I don't think you would even have that thought crossing your mind if I hadn't gotten that email that said lead the anti-mask rally.
Right.
And if the word libertarian, and I'm not blaming people within the Libertarian Party, if the word libertarian had not gotten slopified with anti-vaxxers, even QAnon, it conspiracy theories, it all got slopified into that where the word became unpleasant.
Right.
You know, maybe it's as silly as not saying master bedroom. Maybe it's as silly as that. But maybe it has a little more guts to it.
Yeah. Well, I respect the process that you were just explaining there and things like that. And I guess, and I'm not asking, you know, this isn't where, you know, to go back to the Apocalypse Now thing, like I either got to, you know, get you to sign a libertarian membership card, which I'm not sure if I have any, but, or else we have to, you know, butcher you like Brando or anything like that. But at what point, you know, does, and I totally get the sense of, you know, a lot of people who call themselves libertarian, I'm like, you know, and I'm not in the business of saying what is or isn't, but I know I'm not that. At what point do you start to, you know, question some of the things, you know, now that COVID is, you know, more or less in the rearview mirror, or at least the panic period is?
Yeah,
right?
So weirdly, because it's not in any way except the way we see it.
Well, it's, I mean, there are mortality is way down, partly because of vaccines, and I want to talk about that kind of stuff. But, you know, when, you know, it's masking, it's not clear what it does or doesn't. I mean, in the New York Times, is, you know, every couple of days, they're releasing stories about, like, oh, it turns out that masks aren't as effective as we thought, et cetera. And it's one thing to talk about the early moments of stuff where nobody knows what's going on and a lot of stuff happens.
Sorry, and just to clarify for record, because the contagiousness of the variants also changed.
Right, yeah.
And that also played a factor in mask effectiveness. I just want to...
Perhaps. I mean, but a lot of the mass studies are about, you know, the Delta variant and things like that. I think it's worth from a libertarian point of view to say, like, okay, after a certain point, we knew pretty early on that kids were not as affected by this, and they were also not transmitters in the same way. But, you know, it's kids took this on the chin more than adults.
I mean,
with the exception of Most deaths are people over 70, and which is tragic and awful. And I'm sure we all know a ton of people who were not allowed even to say goodbye. I choke up thinking about this to their parents who are dying because it's like, no, it's too dangerous. You know, that's all fucked up. But it's like, you know, K through 12, and I think we all have younger children under, say, the age of 25 or under 30, whose lives were the most disrupted on a day-to-day basis, even though they were the least likely to get or transmit the disease. Like, we should
I think this was a crazy, drastic experiment we did on ourselves across the board. And I think one of the things that even, you know, we were still podcasting through all of it, and so we had we weren't doing anything, so we had a lot of philosophical conversations. I think the damage we're seeing with children, and also the things that, but also things that also make me tough to look at libertarianism, is that, like, wow, are we not as grossly individual as I thought before the pandemic? We are so much more closely tethered to our families and communities and activities and coworkers and stuff like that, in an actual, like, literal health way that I did not understand before the pandemic.
Mm-hmm.
So it makes me more hesitant to speak so quickly individually about anything.
Right.
When I look at that, when I look at my children's lives or my lives and that kind of thing, it's a kind of thing that when you bring it up, it immediately definitely cuts both ways.
Right.
As you bring that up.
Well, it's also interesting. I mean, because Penn, your definition of libertarian has never been that, you know, I alone run the universe, mm-hmm. right? You've always have talked about, you know, you use the, for decades have used the analogy of saying, you know, I believe in, you know, you don't drink, people should be allowed to drink, but mm-hmm. they shouldn't be allowed to drive drunk mm-hmm. because, you know, so, I mean, you've always had a bounded conception of mm-hmm. what libertarian means and what individual rights mean. And perhaps we come out of all of this with a sharper sense of, if we're trying to be serious, where we want to give people as much ability to make decisions in their life that matter, but also recognizing that we live in a society.
But there's also been, there's this very, very targeted problem with libertarianism when you deal with a virus.
Mm-hmm.
It is where we got really good arguments for roads. We got really good arguments for schools.
Right.
That's all. Whether they're accurate, whether they work or not, we don't care.
Right, right.
But there is a good, strong argument.
You mean for kind of allowing the private sector to...
Yeah. We don't know if it works.
Right, right, right.
We got an argument.
Yeah.
It looks really good on paper, and you could stand up and make the argument to anybody.
Yeah.
And it's not embarrassing. It's a reasonable argument. When you come down to a virus, you've got this huge problem. And we have to, and this is so difficult, because we have to slice it thinner and thinner from what we knew.
Mm-hmm.
So I almost want to go to an ideal situation or worse situation that didn't really exist. But if there is a virus, and if there is a vaccine, and if there are some people who can't take that vaccine because they are vulnerable, immune systems, problems like that, or age, or even money, they can't take that vaccine, especially when the libertarian, if there's money involved. And if there are people that could get that vaccine and not transmit it, or not get that vaccine and transmit it to those people moving freely, we come down to what Ready Rich has said, which is everybody believes my body, my control, except that nobody does.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know, Ready Rich came in with the example today of we can be very, very, very pro-choice.
Mm-hmm.
But when a woman is carrying a baby to 8 months and 2 weeks, how many of us feel really good about abortion then?
Right.
You know, all those kinds of things. But within the integrity of your body, if your body can be weaponized by a virus to kill other people, I don't think I'm making any sort of argument here, pro-libertarian or anti-libertarian. I'm just saying it gets wicked hard.
Yeah, sure.
But this, it gets wicked hard.
I agree, but this is also, you know, maybe the difference between something like polio or smallpox and COVID after vaccines or after we have a certain amount of knowledge. So it's like if we say you have a virus that's going around that's going to kill 50% of the people you encounter, you know, is there a role for the government to say, you know what, we have a vaccine that is perfect and that either has no side effects or very few side effects. Is there a role for a mandate in that kind of situation? Yeah. I believe there is from a libertarian perspective, because again, I'm not an anarchist.
Right.
You know, and then when you get to a position, I was just checking this morning to make sure I was up to date, 67% of Americans are fully vaccinated against COVID at this point, two-thirds. The infection rates are very low. You know, we're talking ultimately the infection fatality rate is somewhere below 1%. If you're in a certain class of people, it's going to be higher than that. It's going to be lower than that, depending on various things. Virtually everybody can get the vaccine, which minimizes the problems. There are some people who are immunocompromised who can't. Now we get into a question of saying, like, you know, how much do we limit the free movement, the free choices of people in society to protect that small percentage who are immunocompromised? Mm-hmm. Do we build our society
Penis
around
this
stuff like that? Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I mean, how, you know, I recognize, and again, one of the things that I think you've always done, which is great, and within the broad libertarian conversation, is bring emotionality into it, because you're a skeptic, you're a rationalist, you're smart, but you always talk about stuff really, you know, from the gut, which is rare.
Well, I don't think that's, I mean, this is going off yeah. a little bit on a tangent, but the reason I talk about the emotional stuff is so I can have the rational stuff.
Sure.
You can't buy one without the other.
Yeah.
And all I try to do is to draw a line there and say, now I know I'm talking emotionally, I'm talking politically.
Yeah. Oh, I think we need more of that. I think we need more of like honest emotionality and all of, you know, certainly political discourse.
Once you've labeled it,
yeah.
I believe you get a pass when you label it.
Yeah.
Maybe I try to reach for too much of a pass, but I do think you deserve a pass when you go, I'm going to make my logical argument later.
Sure.
But I want to tell you where it grew out of. Yeah.
But how do you feel now? I mean, of like where we are as a country, what are, you know, what are the restrictions coming out of COVID that should stay in place, and what are the ones that should disappear?
Well,
because,
I mean,
I was thinking, and one of my colleagues, you know, and I said, hey, I'm going to be talking to Penn, and he said, you know, one of the first, he saw you guys live not long after 9/11, where, you know, you built into your act a whole thing about, you know, the metal detector and going through the metal detector and giving away your rights. And you talked about the reaction to 9/11 as in many ways an overreaction.
What did, you know, I was just going to say, before you brought that up, I was going to say TSA. It's my whole argument on the virus thing is TSA. My first time flying, I went to Budapest to do a movie.
Please tell me you were doing a command performance for Viktor Orban, because overseas you're a fascist.
Then we will win a lot of fans. If I say I was doing a comic book movie.
Yeah,
but I remember being there with all the masks and stuff. And there's the TSA stuff checking for bombs on planes. I'm just going. We should have just said, I mean, wouldn't it have been wonderful if the world had just said, okay, now there's the virus, fuck the whole TSA thing. We're not doing that anymore.
Well, the one concession TSA made, like, and you were talking about occupational licensing went out the window for a while. TSA at one point said, okay, you can bring on like, you know, 50-gallon jugs of hand sanitizer. Other liquids, you know, it's still, you can't,
flammable hand sanitizer.
Yeah, you can't have enough, you know, moisturizer to wet your cheeks, but you just call it hand sanitizer and bring it on.
Well, I mean, that's,
I now call napalm hand sanitizer, because it does, it kills whatever's on your hands.
I guess, you know, I think what he's poking at, and as someone who's been an observer, like, I am the people who talk to you.
Right.
My libertarian guide was Penn on Penn Radio when I was living in New Jersey.
Yeah.
You know, to being in the seat now and being around him. And basically, he got co-opted by people who aren't pro-science. And I think Penn is more pro-science than anything else.
Yeah.
More than libertarianism, or maybe not more than atheism. But, you know.
Right.
They're the same thing.
Yeah.
Correct. Yeah. You know, and I think it was disappointment. Yes?
Yeah.
I think it was really just, you were let down by a lack of scientific thinking.
Well, there was, if I may, there's definitely a contingent of people, you know, of libertarian, I'm trying to come up with the right phrase, of people who designate themselves as libertarian or whatever, that went from being anti-mandate to being anti-vaccine. And maybe they were anti-vaccine before COVID. or anti-science, et cetera.
We can just, and then this is one of the fun things we do on my podcast, is talk about the number of times I'm wrong. It is remarkable. It is almost supernatural.
Yeah.
I said, and you remember, I said this to you, Matt Donnelly.
Yeah.
I said, all these fucking anti-vaxxers, man, when that COVID vaccine hits, they just gonna shut up.
Yeah.
Remember how many times you said that?
Yeah, yeah.
That'll just shut them the fuck up. And I believed it, Nick, in every fiber of me. I just said, you know, they're going to come up with the vaccine for COVID, which incidentally they did in 3 days.
Right.
Which is the most amazing thing.
And it could have come to market much sooner without any compromise in health, but for the FDA.
Yep. Yeah. I think we agree. But I thought for sure, you know, the Jenny McCarthy fools, you know, the people that were killing children with measles and shit, that once this vaccine would come out, you would say to, I'm just going to use an arbitrary name, Jenny, you know, you're going to say to Jenny, I thought you were shut the fuck up, stick it in my arm. I was sure that was going to happen.
Yeah.
And when there was a stronger anti-vax movement on that, see, the thing is, if you're going to call yourself a libertarian, and then you're going to say, I have a right to not get the vaccine because Bill Gates is putting a tiny chip into me through this to control me and get kiddie porn to be done through a pizza shop there, I'm going to say, you know, that club we belong to, that libertarian thing, I'm not going to show up for the next meeting.
Right. And by the way, this segment is brought to you by Microsoft and Pedo Island. Pizza. We serve peanuts on the plane to Pedo Island.
But you know, I mean... That's what bothered me. And I think, and I keep coming back to this, and I'm not coming back to this literally, I'm coming back to this poetically. Mm-hmm. I think when you say, Penn, we believe, and there's 300 of us on this email chain, we believe that you're the guy that's going to stand up and tell people not to wear masks. Mm-hmm. On that date, not now when we know a lot more, but on that date, I am going to have a strong reaction to that. Mm-hmm. And
did you use cunt in the reply? They were like, hey, you know what? Maybe don't show up.
I think that's really the crux of it. That I want to talk about freedom. Mm-hmm. I want to talk about smaller government, which is the same as freedom. I'll even talk about I'll talk about gun rights. Mm-hmm. I'll talk about any of that kind of stuff. But if you've got a term that's going to put me back into that moment where someone's asking me to speak out against masks when, and I'm not claiming anything special here, when people I loved were killed by the virus, I'm going to bristle.
Yeah.
That's my only claim.
Right. And you still think when you read an article about a policy, you still think immediately, I bet this can be solved with more freedom.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Right. Mm-hmm. You know, I think it's harder now than ever to say libertarianism as a singular thing. Whoever said, we're no longer dealing with a marketplace of ideas, but we're dealing with a marketplace of realities. Hmm. You know, when every single website you go to caters to your leanings, when everything you read tells you to swing one side or the other, it feels like it's very hard to even find a place to put a tent pole down to put a marketplace of ideas up right now. I think that's
don't you feel, and I guess this goes to something I wanted to ask you about, because in some of your comments, and I'm thinking you gave a spectacular interview on Big Think on July 15th, 2020. It's up everywhere. And that's where, you know, which is early on in this whole process and things. And you know, what's great about it is you speak as you think. I mean, you don't hide the ball or anything like that, but, in that, you know, I was going to say, you made some comments there and elsewhere about how you had started out thinking, you know, when we got rid of things like the legacy media and whatnot, and we got rid of the guardrails where suddenly the barriers to entry to talking and to, you know, having discussions and having different types of journalism, different types of media, all of that kind of stuff, that would be utopia or something like it. And now you're not so sure.
Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about that? Because this, and Matt, to your point, I hear what you're saying.
I
know from, you know, Reason was founded in 1968. I became editor-in-chief in 2000. And we benefited so massively from the internet, and more than the internet, like the lowering of the costs of being able to put a message out there and gain an audience. It became cheaper. Right. It became easier. And I understand now we're in a very sour, pessimistic period as a country and as a culture. And there's, you know, we're now in a new Tower of Babel, and there's just too much out there. And it's, you know, there's too much misinformation and disinformation, et cetera. I'm still really optimistic about this because I think, you know, well, there's a pony in there somewhere.
Yeah, yeah. I think that my whole point of view, conveniently,
yeah,
was written up by Jonathan Rauch.
Right, okay, yeah. And the Constitution of Knowledge.
I can't think of anything better to say about that.
Right.
I mean, the optimism that you're speaking of, mm-hmm, is Wikipedia.
You know, right.
How can we do Wikipedia more,
right,
and do less of this? And I also, I got to tell you, I can't completely lose my optimism,
mm-hmm,
because I do think, I did not think there would be a rough period with one man, one channel. Mm-hmm. To quote Fire Sign Theater,
yeah,
you know, when everybody right, has a TV station.
Right.
I didn't think there would be this amount of discomfort, mm-hmm, but there is. It's kind of what I was saying about, what I would often say about terrorism, which was, this is the death throes of religion.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's horrible, but it's actually showing a good thing. I mean, religion, the amount of religion has been going down.
Right.
It still is going down. And there was that surprising article in the Times a couple of days ago that if you really want to think globally, things are getting better,
right,
really fast.
Yeah.
We don't have Rwanda.
Mm-hmm.
And once you have that cleaned up,
right,
Ukraine seems like nothing.
Right.
I mean, it's a much smaller thing.
Do you feel, and you know, at times you've talked,
And things are getting better.
Yeah.
Even this time,
when, right,
we want to be as pessimistic as possible, the world is better, even if the U.S. seems a little dingy.
Well, that's what, you know, I mean, part of Trump seems to me to be more the effect than the cause of a breakdown of something.
Oh, there's no doubt, sure, yeah.
You know, sure. Biden, I mean, like, you know, I think part of the reality that people are grappling with now, because, you know, Trump, he's obviously going to try to come back, you know, he's Napoleon and Elba or whatever, you know, maybe will, maybe won't, but, you know, there's not a lot of future left for Donald Trump in America.
Well, no one tried to stop him except McDonald's. They're doing their best. they are really, we got to just give a little credit right there.
Yeah.
They just keep pumping him the Big Macs.
Yeah. But,
you know, you talk about like executive power or whatever. Like, I mean, look, no one's thrilled with Biden.
Right. But that's more of a sign that we're in a long-term process.
Yeah, I agree.
That, you know, and is what we're going through in America, and I think Trump, he couldn't articulate it, but he was hooked into the idea that, you know, America may be where England and France were after World War II, where, you know, we're world powers, but we really aren't anymore. The world is moving on, and we're still going to matter, and we're still going to be important, but we really can't, you know, we're not the center of the world anymore, and that, mm-hmm, is hard to deal with, and some of the comments I've heard you talk about, you know, are kind of generational. You know, you're getting up there, mm-hmm, in age, and the world, like a lot of your references, like mine, are from, you know, ancient galaxies ago in the 1970s.
How about that, Bob Hope?
Yeah, well, no, you know, I one of the things, I think I picked it up in Matt's Twitter feed originally, but from a couple days ago, but there's that meme of Penn and Teller being killed in a Sega video game by Lou Reed.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And I realized to 99% of the people alive today, they are like, none of those words make sense. But it's like, I was like, oh my God, that is such a wonderful world. But what I'm saying is, you know, as we get older, we worry about, you know, that our world is in both literal and figurative ways ending. And that's a tragedy. It's a tragedy for me. Mm-hmm. When I die, no one will be more sad than me. But it's also like you're saying, you know, the world is getting better. And, mm-hmm. you know, even life in America in most ways, I would absolutely rather be my kids than me. If I had to roll the dice and say, when are you going to be born? In the same way, I would much rather have been me than my parents.
Yeah. I think,
oh, wow, that's a frightening thing.
I think that's true. There are a few things. Democracy in the United States is certainly being rolled back.
What does that mean, though? I mean, people are angry and they fight more.
No,
but
no.
What do you mean?
I think what it means is the gerrymandering mm-hmm. and the individual control of the polls and stuff like that okay. that may be happening, I think is a step backwards. Mm-hmm. I think we should have been moving away from the Electoral College. Mm-hmm. I think the idea that, I'm not the expert on this, but the fact that a person in Wyoming has 50 times the power of a person in California, you know, they're...
I think the only reason we're talking about that is because of Trump, who won one election and will never be. I mean, he's demonstrated that he can't win. He can't win a majority of America. He's not going to do better in 2024, assuming, you know, that, you know, the McFlurries haven't put him under.
Whether it's an important thing
yeah.
or whether it's not an important
right.
thing, it's not a good thing.
Right.
I mean, you can say it's trivial, but you can't say it's good.
Yeah. I'd say like a frustrating thing is like,
you know, if I may be a dick here, just like if, you know, if we're in the 21st century and we created vaccines, you know, effective vaccines against COVID in 3 days, and you're saying, you know, the real problem is those fucking Wyoming people have so much power. They have their cowboy boots on my neck.
Absolutely.
We have
right.
so won.
You are so correct.
You know,
you're just 100% correct in that point. Okay. Exactly true. But they're.
Well, to our listeners in Wyoming, we love you.
Yeah, they're the best because sadly, though, they don't have 50% more spending power. So actually, fuck Wyoming. Where is it? It doesn't. It's just part of Colorado, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, you know, this is there are five states that Penn and Teller have never played, and I want to play them. And one of them is Wyoming. So let's lay off that. Okay.
Is West Dakota one of them as well?
Or,
yeah. No, but so, but and, you know, I do want to point out. I mean, I do think like the world generally and America is getting better, which doesn't mean there aren't many, many things that are wrong. Like nobody should ever say, you know, shut up, your car has a really good stereo system
right.
now, and you can listen to Spotify on it while you drive, so shut the fuck up, George Floyd.
Right? Like,
why was George Floyd upset about anything? That's a bad way of thinking.
Yeah, bad.
I'd say, like, at the moment, we're feeling more of, like, the casual optimism that Penn used to instill mm-hmm. in the cooler heads will prevail seems challenged.
Right.
And in a way that's still okay, if, you know, it looks like we're going to have to be really huge advocates again. Like people we admired in the 60s and things like that. Like, I think we're going to have to be advocating for women's autonomy. I think we're going to have to advocate for separation of church and state.
Yeah.
Like, mm-hmm. I think these are, like, I think we have to wake up and be passionate advocates again.
Sure.
And I think that's where libertarians are more equipped and maybe other people are.
Well, that's kind of, it's kind of funny if you think about it that way, right? Like, where it's like what we're maybe or what you're pissed off about is like, you're John Wayne in The Shootist or something. You hung up your spurs and your six gun. You just want to die in peace, right? Maybe knock a piece off of Lauren Bacall, who's running the house you're living in. And it's like these fucking guys keep coming for you.
Yeah.
Right? You can't take a shit. You can't go to the outhouse without somebody trying to knock you off.
Yeah. And it's also that the battles that I feel like I have to be part of now are not the fun ones.
Yeah.
I mean, it's fun to be a nut on the abortion thing. Mm. I'm not a nut.
Right.
I just want women to have their right.
Yeah.
That's not a nut position. Yeah. That's not a fun position.
Right.
You know?
No.
It's, you know, it's a fun
position. You don't want them to be able to drive, but you do want them to be able to have, no. No, seriously. And can maybe, you know, because one of the things, and
but
again.
But I mean, that's a big deal for me.
Yeah,
the
no, I'm
that,
not.
The
yeah.
fact that what I'm talking about yeah. is now I liked when I could say nut stuff that was over here. Mm-hmm. And now the fact that there are battles that need to be fought, right?
Yeah.
The fact that every single libertarian should be aligned with every single Democrat in getting the women the right to their bodies. Mm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, whether the libertarians are going to say the government should pay for da-da-da-da,
right.
shut the fuck up.
Right.
We don't want laws against this, you know?
Yeah.
And the fact that, I mean, in a weird way, it's kind of inside out.
Right.
The fact is that the libertarians that share my heart are now with the Democrats on a lot of things.
Yeah.
And that feels creepy.
What else? Because, and I agree, you know, it's interesting. So I've been a professional libertarian, I guess, since 93 when I joined the staff of Reason. And I would say when I started, being pro-choice was every bit as much as being, you know, in favor of lower taxes, yeah, being against the draft.
What was that wonderful, there was a wonderful thing that said, I believe in a married gay couple's right to protect their marijuana crop.
Right, with semi-automatic weapons or something. Yeah, 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 absolutely.
There was that wonderful sentence
yeah.
there. That
and, you know, it up. Used to be the T-shirt was kind of pro-choice on everything,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and it's interesting to me, and I respect libertarian, you know, people libertarian calling people, designated people who disagree with me on a lot of stuff. And it's a surprise to me how many self-described libertarians are anti-abortion or will say, I believe that abortion is murder because life begins at conception. And I, you know, I disagree with them and I argue with them, but it is a change. And like the world we live in is different than, you know, the 90s or the 70s. And you know, many things. I feel this way about kind of open borders or not open borders per se, but like mass immigration. I thought we had won the battle, that it was great. It's a better world when people are free to move where they want and live and work and prosper legally. I thought we had won debates about free trade, which is now, you know, under attack by people who call themselves libertarians and right-wingers and left-wingers. So there's that. Mm-hmm. And part of it, I mean, is part of it, you know, that you were not expecting to be fighting, or and it's not that you're fighting, but like you thought these were kind of settled issues
yeah.
within something that you thought of as a tribal identity. And now you're like, this tribe, these aren't my people.
Yeah, I mean, I think there was that. There was also, I am constantly trying to not be tribal.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it goes against so much that's
yeah,
human.
Yeah.
But I say to my children all the time, I say, you are one of one or you're one of 7 billion.
Right.
You don't have a choice in between. You're either speaking for yourself or you're part of this whole world. And we haven't even got into the really hairy things, you know. And I think it's okay to bring up stuff that there does not seem to be an easy solution.
Sure.
Which is climate change.
Mm-hmm.
Which, although I wanted to be doubtful about that mm-hmm. for years and years and years, seems impossible to be doubtful now about it.
That by that you mean that human activity
yeah.
is having an impact on climate.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's pretty hard to deny
sure.
that now.
I know very few people who do. And then there are questions about, okay, given that, what do you do next?
Right, of course. That's an entirely different thing.
Right.
But I'm telling you that I wasn't even there.
Right.
Until
the early teens, right?
Yeah,
or something. I mean,
yeah,
you were kind of a late.
Very late. Very
well,
late
can
that.
I ask you about
and
the.
For no, and for no, and I think just. I just wasn't good at it.
Yeah. You know, one of. Well, or
I thought I had something better to say.
It didn't
Hold,
matter that
Hold.
Much. It didn't matter that much
yeah.
to you, so you didn't really pay that much attention and you were cruising on your default setting, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's all. You know, you mentioned, and we've talked a bunch about the late 60s and early 70s, you bring up tribalism, And tribalism, the way we talk about it now, is always terrible, I think. You know, I mean, and rightfully so. Like, I don't believe that I'm, you know, I mean, I have my tribes, but like when people talk about, you know, who are you a Republican or a Democrat or this, or even libertarian, I'm kind of like, you know, I don't want to be part of a tribe where it's like being in a gang where, you know, you get beat into the gang and then you have to do whatever the gang wants. You don't have any autonomy in it. That seems horrible. I'm curious, you know, when I think of libertarianism as a more of as a direction or as an adjective, rather, libertarian is a direction. It's a adjective. It's a temperament. And it's kind of like the way you were saying, and I'm sure I'm getting this deeply from you, that it's the default setting is like, let's think about whether or not whatever we're talking about would be better with more freedom or less. Sometimes the answer is no. Mm-hmm. To talk about tribes, you know, there was the human being in January of 1967 in San Francisco that Timothy Leary spoke at and Allen Ginsberg spoke at and the Grateful Dead played
Why
at.
Why couldn't bunch. I have been there? I was 14. Yeah,
you should have been. Been able yeah, to get there. You know, but it was also called a gathering of tribes.
Yeah,
and like, can we, maybe this is something that libertarians should talk about more or think about of like, when you say to your kids, you're either, you know, a tribe of one or 7 billion, actually you can be part of like 10 or 15 different tribes simultaneously, and that tribes don't have to be at war.
I see, you know, when you have children and you see them start to build an identity with what they are, it can make you look at yourself an awful lot. You know, we use Windows. We don't use Apple because mm-hmm. Windows are the gamer thing to do. And if you're all the assholes are not gamers, so we've got to have Microsoft on this. And you know, there's this video game you've got to play, and this mm-hmm. one you don't. And you, I hate TikTok, but I love Reddit. Mm-hmm. And I think they just think I'm having a stroke and mumbling. I just go, you know, Rolling Stones and Beatles. You know, we're the Stones. Yeah, Beatles yeah. are oh God, shut the fuck up.
Right.
But and there I come back to this very often. There's a book about Celine Dion. It's got Love in the title. I know what it is, but it was.
I know what you're talking about. It was by a guy who's a critic, it's a real homage to her.
But it's much more. Have you read it?
No, obviously not.
You got to read it because he just makes the point that our taste, mm-hmm. the fact that we don't like Celine Dion, right. and none of us do, the fact that we don't is this class thing signaling all of that. Totally separate from the music mm-hmm. or anything like that. Sure. We all pretend the rock snob thing taken to the nth degree.
Yeah.
And all I do is as I roll over and over that, I just go, when is it not fun? When do we cross the line to not fun? Now, I know nothing about sports. I don't care about sports. But I do know that it's supposed to be fun tribalism. Right. But then there's a moment when they kill each other at soccer match
right.
where I don't think it's fun anymore.
Yeah.
You know.
So and Carl Wilson's Let's Talk About Love.
Let's Talk About Love. It's an incredible book. Yeah. So I watch my children do this stuff that is 100% harmless. Mm-hmm. You know, when I was, when I thought the Mothers were a great band and who would ever play James Taylor, mm-hmm. you know, that was harmless. And it's harmless up until you get to QAnon. Right. And then that's a club you really want to be part of. I mean, no one understands this, but some of the stuff that I've read about QAnon say that it's all about friendship mm-hmm. and a lack of loneliness.
Sure.
It's not about information at all. And you want to go, Jesus, what's wrong? And then you go, oh, well, that's me on everything too.
Right.
And I just want to try to constantly remember that and constantly remember that even though I made appearances on talking head TV shows saying stuff, and they put libertarian under my picture or something, that eventually we have to deal with real issues. Mm-hmm. Eventually there is a young woman in Mississippi that needs an abortion, mm-hmm. and going on and saying outlandish stuff on TV and making a joke, I guess we still got to do that. But there's real work to do. You know, I had the other thing of being in Australia when a lot of the January 6th hearings were going on, mm-hmm. and when the Supreme Court ruling on Roe v. Wade came down. And that also gives you another perspective. Sure. I've been wanting to say this, like it doesn't fit in here. I've been wanting to say it. I also listened to the Obama book, The Promised Land. Mm-hmm. And LOD, Lawrence O'Donnell, yep. had said to me a lot of times, he said, you know, every argument you make for libertarianism, Obama can make better than you. He can make that argument better. He really understands it. And that always really took me as a really powerful thing. Now, I disagree with Obama on, I don't know, everything. Mm-hmm. Okay?
Yeah.
But listening to that book was a remarkable experience because he talks about healthcare and he makes the arguments that I made and want to make and better make. It's what's called the steel man, right? You, mm-hmm. instead of the straw man, you make mm-hmm. the position strong. He makes it really strong and then says, I'm making that decision. I'm making a different decision, but this is, I understand the opposite. Mm-hmm. Now, when it comes down to war and shit, I couldn't disagree more. But he really, and he understands the position of Gandhi and Martin Luther King. Mm-hmm. He really does. He just made a different decision. And I think what needs to be required from a politician is, even though I disagree with Obama on an awful lot, mm-hmm. and even though you can make the argument, and I think you can make it very, very well, that Trump's change in policy was not that different, or maybe in many of the things we really care about better than Obama's, I think I need to require among the people I put in the power of leadership, I need to require that they have the sensibility of Obama, where he seems to be sanely making decisions. I would rather have a decision made incorrectly by someone who is sane and weighing the options than I would have a decision made correctly by a lunatic.
Right.
And I think that may be my summation of the Obama-Trump thing.
Right.
Because I really think I need, and maybe this is some sort of, like people who believe in conspiracy theories having to have a father figure that they can blame. Hmm. Maybe it's just that I just want who's sitting in that cockpit, you know, as I'm the passenger, to be someone who actually understands what's going on, even if the net effect is not that.
So even if they're crashing the plane, they are
like Joe Biden.
I know.
Put the plane. You need that plane. Yeah.
There was nothing else he could have said. You had no free will whatsoever there. You had to say, even if the plane is crashing.
We're already in the cheap seats here. We're already eating the bodies. So we're like a South American soccer team on this side of the microphone.
Incidentally, didn't have to eat anybody.
Oh, is that right?
No.
Oh, well, can we talk about veganism a little bit? Yeah, I mean, they were in the jungle. Yeah. It was a plant-rich environment. They could have gotten better protein. How is that going for you? And I want to, well, before we move on to that, I appreciate what you said. And
tonight
also
in a very special 7-hour interview.
I just keep putting fast forward until I get to the veganism.
Yeah.
Can of bees are you opening now, sir?
Well, what I was going to say is that I think that's really a great way of clarifying where you are and why that matters. And I think that resonates with a lot of people. And it's, as long as we're all, to me, the real epidemic in America, or one of them, is like nobody is arguing in good faith. So that it's just that,
And the fucking word evil.
Yeah.
Can we just ban that word?
Yeah, yeah.
Because as crazy and as misguided as people are, evil is a supernatural concept.
No, it's a pre-modern theological know, imputation of something.
And the idea that every discussion is about gamesmanship instead of an actual discussion.
Right, for
and
sure.
And I have, you know, I have my good friend Robbie, who works with us, who says all the modern breakdown we're experiencing, Trump and everything else, is Hillary Clinton's fault.
Yep.
It's when she was running for Senate in New York, and everybody said, well, she's kind of scummy, but she's our scummy. That's when everything broke down.
Yeah. I'm willing to roll it back to like the Kennedy assassination. I like that search for a moment, you know, when everything began. But I don't know that we need that. But I do think we need the process going forward of having these conversations and steelmanning people and then also understanding. And I appreciate your, you know, talking about like where am I coming from in a conversation? Because that never happens, or it rarely happens, where people are willing to say, this is who I am, this is where I'm coming from. And it means my viewpoint is limited and is going to change. For me, to bring it all back home to Bob Dylan, what I like about that is that he's constantly changing. And that's a good thing. Like if you were the same person you were 40 years ago, that would be kind of a tragedy, right?
And we're learning that on the other side too, I think. I think that the idea that someone changes should not be a gotcha moment.
Right.
It should be the opposite. It should be a celebration.
So you want to celebrate Bill Gates for finally admitting that he went to Jeffrey Epstein's island, right?
Sure.
Yes.
Yeah.
That should actually be praised. That was a mistake, but I did it.
Right.
Yeah. And I lied about it earlier. You should be like, let's treat him a little differently than how we were treating him, you know?
I agree. Very quickly, veganism. When I last interviewed you, you came out with your book, Presto.
Yep.
Where you had lost 100 pounds, you seem to have mostly kept it off.
Yeah,
you have
about 31. I lost more than 100. Lost about 130. About 30.
Right.
30 have come back on. Now 20 have come off.
So yeah,
it's always a battle.
What I wanted to ask you about regarding that, because partly inspired by you, I went on a vegan diet for several years, I enjoyed it. I stopped doing it after a while because it wasn't working for me health wise, but. You have also, one of the things that was remarkable in the book, you kind of crowed about being an unethical vegan.
Yeah.
Because you said you were just doing it for health reasons, essentially. You have become an ethical vegan. Mm-hmm. And can you talk a little bit about what that means?
Boy, that was a nutty thing that happened.
Yeah.
And it's also happened to almost everyone I know that went through that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, I forgot the woman's name who wrote, why do we wear cows, eat pigs, and keep dogs or something. Mm-hmm. Some book or some title like that. But I heard her interviewed. I didn't read the book. Heard her interviewed. She made this point that nobody, and I mean that nobody is not the real nobody.
Right.
But nobody feels good about industrial farming.
Mm-hmm.
No, of course, nobody feels good about that, factory farming. No one would sit in a pig slaughterhouse and go, I'm sure glad I eat pulled pork.
Mm.
Nobody would do that. So we spend so much time, and I, with this resolution of cognitive dissonance, where you say, well, I don't like that factory farming, but I want a cheeseburger now, you know. And when you take that cheeseburger away, and you're not eating it for health reasons, all of a sudden the muscles that you had developed to justify the eating of meat and the justifying of the cruelty just go away.
Right.
They just simply go away. I had this incredible arsenal of personal arguments that allowed me to eat meat. And then I stopped eating meat, and those arguments, whether they were valid or not, doesn't matter.
Right.
I just stopped making them to myself.
Yeah.
So when all of a sudden I was confronted with this amount of suffering, I didn't have them at my fingertips anymore. Mm-hmm. I didn't have my quick answer because I just got
lazy. So you freed up, you know, kind of like computing capacity for other things, right? Yeah.
And the one thing is I remember arguing with a vegan back when I wasn't, when I was a carnist, I guess you want to say. Mm. And him saying, well, you know, the suffering of chickens is like the suffering of people. This is the Holocaust.
No, and this is the head of PETA years ago made this, you know,
going insane
analogy.
And that is so easy.
Yeah.
It's a shame because normally when we call something else a Holocaust, we're usually dead on.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, it really does bring out the best arguments normally. Yeah.
And
assuming it happened. Right? That was the problem with the PETA argument, right?
Yeah. You so easy to dismiss.
Yeah.
So easy to dismiss. And it just came to me, and I'm sure others have made this argument, but it came to me alone that I just said, wait a minute, we don't have to argue about chicken suffering versus human suffering, or cows' love for their calves versus humans' love for their children. We don't have to make that argument at all. What if the suffering of 1 million chickens adds up to the suffering of one person's stubbed toe? Doesn't matter. We still like a little less suffering. I think that the PETA overstating of that argument is what completely fucked me up.
Yeah.
Because if you make it a very minor thing, like if you just want to say, boy, slaughterhouses smell bad and make me feel creepy. That's all you need.
Yeah. So,
then the environmental, you know, if people went vegan, it's bigger than all the cars.
Right.
You know, so.
Which don't taste good anyway.
Right, exactly. Yeah.
As a final point.
Are you going to tie it in with the rapture?
I would love to.
Now just eating cars?
Yeah, trust me. Every time I see a car, like if I'm driving down the highway and a car is just like obviously crashed, mm-hmm. I'm looking for, do they have the, if the rapture comes, this car will be driverless? Wow. And I'll be like, come on. You know, but I know I'm going to be left.
Things.
Yeah.
I was talking about rapture, the single by Blondie.
Oh,
where she
says, I'm sorry.
Now they're only eating cars.
Yeah, no,
Cadillacs and Subarus.
I speak of Bob Dylan's rapture. Very quickly, you know, because this brings us back to libertarianism, because it seems to me, whatever people might say and whatever you might say, you're still profoundly libertarian in that you believe that, you know, people should have respect and dignity, autonomy, mm-hmm. empathy, and choice in their life. Like, that's what matters, like to become who you want to become. There's limits within it and stuff. But when we talk about veganism, vegans, and I think this is unfair often, but they often are stand-ins for people who are so shrewish and so zealous and so self-righteous. They're like Christians, you know, well, in this way.
Isn't that all that joke about, you know, how can you tell if someone's a cross trainer or someone's a vegan? They tell you.
Exactly.
I mean, there's all those jokes.
But you,
and they're all accurate.
But you believe it. And the statement that you just made, which is a great argument for it and things like that, but you don't believe that you have the right to force people to believe a certain way or to think a certain way.
Well, you know,
how do you maintain that integrity once the truth is revealed to you?
Pacifism and atheism and libertarianism mm-hmm. are all exactly the same. How much right do I have to use force on someone else? Mm. And we've got to bring her back around to this.
Yep.
Fearing not, I become my enemy in the instant that I preach.
Right.
I mean, that's one of the lines,
yeah.
one of the 5,000 lines of Bob Dylan that come
right.
back to me all the time.
Yeah. From my back pages, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I have to, I must, if you're arguing for the limit of force, mm-hmm. let's take it out of Bob Dylan for a second.
If we must.
Let's go to
As long as we're not putting it in Phil Oaks, I'm good with it.
How about we go to Cracker?
Okay, very good, very good.
I don't know what the world may need, but I sure as hell know it starts with me, and that's a wisdom I've laughed at. I tried to get anybody in my social circle to realize that that was the most important thing written to me right now. The past 4 years, 5 years. That is the mantra that goes over and over again in my head.
Would you repeat it again?
I don't know what the world may need, but I sure as hell know it starts with me. And that's a wisdom I've laughed at. Mm. And it's that pause that fucking kills me.
Yeah.
Because he lets you sit with, and that's a wisdom. And you go, yeah I suppose that I laughed at.
Yeah.
And I'm afraid that my my pacifism and all these things kind of tie together. And if people in the libertarian movement feel that they that I betrayed them,
Judas,
my play fucking loud, right? When they yelled, "You Judas" to Bob Dylan, he counted off the song by going, "Play fucking loud." That was 1, 2, 3. Yeah. So maybe that's what I'm saying. Right. If you want to say I'm a Judas, I say play fucking loud. No, I it really does. In the narrative, which is not true,
right?
You know, in the narrative that I feel, the story that I tell myself about my life, when I look back on the time, it was having to look at that email and say, I will not be at a rally telling people not to wear masks. Now, if we got to the point where, are we going to talk about a mandate and stuff, we'd have a long, long, long discussion. But in that June or July of 2020, I was not going to be a person telling people not to wear masks.
All right. I'm sure you were expecting to hear this about 90 minutes ago, but I think we're going to leave it there.
Good.
Matt, thank you so much.
Penn, thanks for having me.
Thank you.
And that was Penn Sunday School.